Srila Prabhupada to me is my Nitya Gurudev, and he is Manjari in the line of Rupa Goswami. And whenever the time comes to go back to Godhead, he will be there to introduce me to Braj. And one time Prabhupada, we were sitting in the room and there were some devotees talking, and he said that the disciple and guru relationship is eternal. Even he said that if you do not become perfect pure devotees in this life, I will come again in next life in some form of or other to guide you, and I will come again third and again as many lives as you take to become pure devotee, I will keep coming to guide you, to take you back to Godhead. So then he said that please don't make me come again and again. Try and do work hard so that maybe in one or two lives you finish, or this life you finish. Don't make me come again and again like that, he said. So this is the guru. He's a Nitya Guru to me. And until I am at in Braja, with as in whatever my Siddha form is, my spiritual form, he will be there all the way till that point, and thereafter also. So our relationship is eternal. I think what, I don't know whether it's inspiration, but the event which made me come to Prabhupada is one service I did in London to one very beautiful looking devotee who was trying to sell magazines on the street. And he was covered by some Indian people who were demoralizing him by saying that he is doing a big mistake by being a follower of Krishna, and that they are from India, and they are they know all about this. This is heathen worship, and you are a born Christian. You should not do this. And I felt this boy was sweating and feeling shaken up, and so I intervened in that crowd and I said to them that I am also from India. And you know, this is wonderful. Are you selling this magazine? Can I buy one of these magazines? And suddenly, as soon as I came there, those people went away, and this boy was very, very blissful again. And I bought the magazine, and I even gave him some extra money, and he became radiant and happy again. So I think when you serve a devotee of Krishna, that is what brings you. This is one service I did, which brought me later on when I was in Canada. I came across the devotees and I joined over there. One particular incident which was very important for me was that in Hyderabad we had finished the temple, and the next day was the inauguration of the temple, and this Vengal Rao, who was the chief minister, was coming to inaugurate, and there was a big ceremony going on, everything was happening, but it was a last minute thing, and temple cleaning was going on. So that particular night before, all the devotees who were there, the brahmacharis and us all, we were just polishing and cleaning. And we finished work at about 2:33 in the morning. And finally at about 2:33, I sent everyone off and I checked everything, that everything is fine, now it's all done. And I was going up to my room and I was so tired that I couldn't walk up to my room. And I just slept on the staircase, not far from Prabhupada's room. 4:30 Mangal Aarti happened, and after Mangal Aarti, there was a devotee called Pallika Devi. She was Bhavananda's wife. She came and woke me up on the step. She says, "What are you doing here? Go quickly, Prabhupada wants to meet you immediately." So I quickly ran and had a cold bath, and within 5 minutes or 7 minutes, I was in his room. And I was full with happiness, I was full with exhilaration that, oh, I did a good job. And I entered with that feeling, you know, and I paid my obeisances with full happiness. And Prabhupada was furious. He was so furious. He just broke me to pieces. He says, "Where were you?" Because from his room he can see the temple and he can see the Mangal Aarti. He says, where was everyone in Mangal Aarti? He said, "Where was everyone in Mangal?" Because nobody came. They finished work at 2:30. You know, I also was very tired, so we didn't go to Mangal Aarti. He says, "Where was everyone in Mangal Aarti?" Nobody was there. Mangal Aarti was empty. So I said, I answered back, "But Prabhupada, the devotees worked very hard till 2:30 in the night, you know." And when I said that, he was furious. He says, "Devotee? Who is the devotee here? You call yourself devotee? You are useless, malacha, this, that, and what not." He sweared. When he gets angry, he can say many things, you know. So he was furious and he was saying, you call yourself devotee? How many years have you been doing any service and you call yourself devotee? You know, and he said so many strong words which I cannot exactly remember now, but it brought me to tears and I was just about to break down. And then when he saw that, he suddenly changed and he became opposite. And he says, "You know, Mahamsa, the Goswamis of Vrindavan, the six Goswamis, Rupa Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, they were seeing Krishna all the time," he said. "They were seeing Krishna all the time. Krishna was with them in their heart all the time. But they never thought that they were devotee. They were always running from one tree to another tree. Where is Krishna? When will I be blessed to see Krishna? When will I have darshan of Krishna? When will Krishna come to me?" They were always in that mood that I am most unfortunate. Krishna is not available to me. They are seeing Krishna, but they never think that they are devotee. So, trenarapi suni chena tarorapi sahishnuna amanina manadena kirtaniya sadhari. This is how he explained, that's all he said. And this I'll never forget, because this is the key to loving sentiment, humility. Without humility, the doors don't open. Without humility, you cannot say, "Na dhanam, na janam, na sundarimba kavitam, jagadisha kama." You cannot say that. First, that humility. And after that, other things of the shikshas to come. So this is one mood of Prabhupada I saw of him in Braja. Today when I reflect on that, that is why I feel he's a manjari of Rupa Goswami. And he is assisting Rupa Goswami in the pastimes of Krishna. And the Goswamis were running mad. He said, running one tree to another tree, running to the birds and to the bees, like how Radharani was talking to the bumblebee. The Goswamis were doing that. And they never thought that I am a great devotee. This teaching of his is most striking to me. After I left ISKCON, I stayed away. It was, to me, it is a reaction to my Vaishnava Prad, because when I was in my final years of ISKCON, I did a lot of fighting with my own god brothers over ego issues. We were into an ego trip. I was into a major ego trip of I and mine in ISKCON. And in that process, in the GBC meetings and in other situations, I was fighting very strongly with my god brothers. And these were not ordinary fights, it was nasty fighting. And because I committed so many offenses against other devotees, my god brothers as devotees, the punishment of that was that after leaving ISKCON, I had no satsang of devotees. My only satsang was with Prabhupada and through his leelas. But I had no personal association with devotees. And that was very difficult and very painstaking. So anyway, during that time, I traveled all over dhams like Badrinath Dham, Gomukh. I did all these yatras. I went to Amarnath, I went to Muktinath, I went to all these places, dhams, and traveled as a sadhu. I grew my hair, I had a beard. So I used to dress like a sadhu and travel with the sadhus all over India. I went to every Kumbh Mela. I stayed in Kumbh Mela for a whole month. And I mixed with all the sadhus of all types, Vaishnava sadhus, Sitaram Babas, Naga Babas, Shankaracharya Bhaktas, all types of sadhus I met in my experiences. Because when you travel, I used to walk with them, sleep with them, eat with them, beg with them, sleep with them. Like an ordinary sadhu on the road, like these mendicant sadhus, sometimes I would go like that. And so I had experience of all types of sadhus. All types I had experience. But every time I'd meet them and some discussion would come out and I would see their lifestyle and I would see their... I respect all sadhus. I give my respect to every sadhu. But in my heart, every time Prabhupada shines out, because none could give what Prabhupada is giving. None of them would give what we are getting through this line of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, this disciplic succession of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the core. There is no other sadhu or philosophy or anything that can be compared to the greatness of this understanding Brajalila. Brajalila, only Chaitanya Mahaprabhu line of disciplic succession gives. Even the Ramanujas, the Vallabhacharyas, the Sri Sampradaya, all these Vaishnava Sampradayas, they go to some level. But Brajalila, the depth of Brajlila that Prabhupada has exposed us to. He has exposed it. Now we have to search. He's always there. He's always there to be with us in our search. As I said, he's a Nitya Guru. He's always there. But we can learn from many others also. So, no sadhu in India, and I met them all, has been able to... which I can see has given us this. And the purity of Prabhupada, his selflessness, his total 100% giving to Krishna I have not seen anywhere. Prabhupada used to, because I don't know how to say it, but he used to tell me to meet a lot of his god brothers, Prabhupada. I used to go to the Bombay Gaudiya Math often, and I used to meet his god brothers quite often. And I feel that there was one, there was at one level an intimate relationship with Prabhupada and his god brothers. Although on one level there were some criticisms also, where his god brothers may have criticized him and he may have criticized his god brothers. But there was another level of high interaction, which was at that time beyond my understanding. And so, after his disappearance, we were all very young devotees. We were hardly 8, 9, 10, 12 years with him. Many people during his last days, there was just about two weeks before he disappeared, in October I think, he called all of us, the GBC members, and he asked us to come and ask what we wanted. So each of the devotees went and said what they wanted. They wanted this position, this. And during that time, there was a group of Indian devotees. I think I had taken Mr. Hari Prasad Bhadruka in there, and there were some other senior devotees, Indian, not devotees, they were devotees, but they were Indian supporters of ISKCON, senior, important people. And the discussion at that time was that they were telling Prabhupada that you should nominate one person to succeed you. Like in all other ashrams, the guru nominates one person to succeed, and then we will all back that person. And Prabhupada at that time said, there is no that one person. And he said, I have to make the best use of a bad bargain. These are the words I'll never forget. He says, I have to make the best use of a bad bargain. The bad bargain is that, not that we are bad people, not that we are bad devotees, but the bargain is that I have to leave this planet so soon, and I have not been able to train any of my disciples to come to that level. And therefore, I nominate the GBC, and I nominate these 11 people to do the Diksha, and I hope my God brothers will help. This was the message he gave. But after he left, I feel there was a little, in the leadership, there was a little antagonism with the leaders of ISKCON and his God brothers, which I think would, if that was avoided, we would have been a better organization today. There was antagonism between the leaders and his God brothers. They are also great devotees, and we should not create offense against them also. And this is, I think, one mistake that we made, for which I have suffered, for which some of my God brothers, senior God brothers, have suffered, and for which ISKCON has suffered. This is something I feel. Now I think things are okay and things are back in shape. After all, and Prabhupada said that this is not my movement, this is Lord Krishna's movement, Chaitanya Dev's movement. He will take care of everything. In that particular meeting, this is what he said, that this is not my I'm just a messenger, I'm just a, one of the persons. It's Krishna's movement. Krishna and Chaitanya Dev will take care of everything. And they have taken care. ISKCON is growing everywhere. But it did take a dip. In the earlier days, it took a dip. A lot of God brothers left the organization. It could have been better. But I was a part of it. I also was a part. Although I never abused any of his God brothers. I always respect them within my heart as great Vaishnavas. This offense against Vaishnavas is something in our madness we do, but then afterwards we repent. Prabhupada was 100% serving Krishna with no personal motive. 100% from morning to evening, he was always with Krishna. And I remember in the earlier days, when we were in Akash Ganga, his lungis had holes in them. He could have asked people to bring him a fancy lungi, but his lungi had holes in them. So he was totally selfless. And he just emanated love, and that's why so many people became devotees, because what's missing in the world is love. And he emanated love, he gave pure love. Everything about Prabhupada was wonderful. Well, everything I know about spiritual life is through Prabhupada's books. And his books have everything in it. And even till today, even after Prabhupada is not only in his physical form, even after he left his body, he still is our guru, and he comes in many forms. Sometimes he gives wisdom through the heart or through the mind, and through his books. He's always there in his books, and we read those books, and at every level he's giving the inspiration till today. Till today, the same book I read again and again, but the wisdom is different, the realization is different. And I remember just before he got sick, just before he went to Vrindavan, before that, he called me one day to his room, and he said that there is one thing I have not done which I want to finish. And I want to finish the Bhagavatam, the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. And he said, I cannot do it with all this management. I want to go to Kodaikanal, where his personal Dr. Ghosh, Dr. Ghosh was his personal health advisor. He had a lot of confidence in Dr. Ghosh. So he says, I want to go in Kodaikanal. You please arrange with Dr. Ghosh for me to stay at his house. For 6 months, I want to be there and do my translation of the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. So by the time I went there and we started building a room for Prabhupada and trying to get the arrangement made, he felt more sick, and then from Bombay he went to Vrindavan, and then he continued and stayed in Vrindavan. So he could not do that. And I think that was what he really felt, something unfinished in his experience. He could not finish the 10th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. He wanted to do that very badly. He wanted to cut out, because Kodaikanal there was not much chance for communication. Therefore he wanted to be isolated. So management would be taken care of by his other servants, and he could be concentrating. He needed some 6 months to finish the 10th canto. This was, I think, his last desire in active service. and he could not do that. But his greatest contribution, I think, besides the many other, everything he did is a great contribution, but his books are his greatest contribution.
Jai Anilo, Prema Dona.